Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and it's time to move on to the next item of business. And the final item of business is a Member's Business Debate on Motion 4364 in the name of Michael Marra on Dundee Drugs Commission Review Report. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and as ever, I would invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function as soon as possible. And I call on Mr Marra to open the debate for around 7 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Earlier this week, I hosted some of the Dundee Drugs Commissioners here in Holyrood to allow MSPs to hear their testimony directly. The deep frustration at the lack of progress in the delivery of their recommendations in both of their reports was palpable. I despair. I actually despair. Those are the words of the Chair of the Commission, Dr. Robert Peat. In reviewing my files in preparation for this debate, I revisited a litany of action papers, a plethora of delivery plans, many statements of intent, thousands of warm words from both political and service leadership in Dundee. Yet here we are. No action, just despair. The cost of not changing is measured in lost lives, ruined families, despair that does not run through just families, but through generations. And at the centre of these reports in the Commission is a model of addiction service that is isolated and outdated, that operates apart from primary care, apart from acute medical care, and in purposeful isolation from mental health care. Staff in Dundee Drug and Alcohol Recovery Services work incredibly hard in very challenging circumstances. They are frequently understaffed. They feel under attack. They want to provide care, and they want to feel proud of the care that they give. But the reality of the service is punitive, it's overly medicalised, and frankly, it's a broken system. The response was to rebrand it for what I believe was the fourth time. Folk in Dundee still call the service the name it had 20 years ago. The name does not matter when it is still doing the same thing. And it's our job here to ask what is stopping real change. And that's my central question to the Minister today. Why, Minister, no change? And I do think that this Government has no real track record of public service reform. I do believe that the lack of Government knowledge of how to lead reform over the last 15 years and the lack of thirst to see it happen is part of the problem. And let me give Parliament an example. One of the key findings of the Dundee Drugs Commission was that addiction services and mental health services could not be accessed in tandem by one suffering individual. In fact, accessing addiction services meant you specifically could not access mental health services. Now, I don't believe anybody in this chamber or anybody working in these services or any family believe that mental health and substance abuse are not linked. For so many, they are two sides of the same coin. But it was not just this Commission and these commissioners that came to this conclusion. The Dundee Poverty Commission, years ago, said the same thing. The Strang Review into the dreadful state of our mental health services in Tayside said the same thing. And yet a very senior officer in the Dundee Health and Social Care Partnership said to me, "We do not recognise this description." This has gone way past a lack of evidence or analysis. It is obdurate refusal to listen, to accept a truth, because that would mean that change has to happen. And I believe that the Minister knows it, that she shares some of the same frustrations. The Minister's own report just last week on MAT standards said that despite cast-iron assurances of implementation, we know, as a Parliament and as a country, we are nowhere near it. Dundee has had even longer, because MAT Standard 1 on same-day prescribing, as the Minister will know, was required by the first report of the Commission, the Dundee Drugs Commission, 3 years ago. But ministerial direction, I'm afraid, will not cut it. And if I would ask the Minister one question today, it is that question of why. Why can this not change? What is stopping change, Minister? Is it money? Is it people? Is it culture? Why has Scotland seemed to have lost the ability to adapt and to move? But let us be clear. Moving all decision-making to the centre would be a real disaster. The character and the nature of drug abuse differs hugely from town to town, from city to city. Services must be designed and procured locally. Because even in my region, the difference between the kind of behaviours and substances that are used in Aberdeen differs markedly to what happens in Dundee. It has to be responsive. And if there's one thing that I have learned, particularly from this commission, it's the character of drug abuse in the city. We all know the cost, but actually the character of what happens, the particular problem of benzodiazepine use, the increasing impact on women and the loss of female lives, and the huge link with poverty that's actually particularly pronounced in Dundee has been set out clearly. So the Dundee Drugs Commission is now closed. The commissioners wish to pass the baton, and they have given 4 years to this work. They've listened to harrowing testimony, some of them reliving trauma from their own past and their present lives. And they have our thanks, but frankly, they don't want it. They want progress. But they are certainly due our respect, which has, in my belief, been sorely lacking from those who their reports gently but rightly damn. The commissioners demand real leadership of reform. They demand permanent, external, independent scrutiny because they clearly have no faith in current systems of accountability. And what they ask of us as politicians is determination. The people of Dundee are demanding change so the lives of our friends, our relations, our fellow Dundonians might be saved.
Thank you, Mr. Marra. We now move to the open debate. I call Joe Fitzpatrick, to be followed by Claire Baker for around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful to my computer for switching back on, please. Apologies. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful to the Dundee Drugs Commission for their review report, and I want to recognise the considerable work undertaken by all those involved, in particular to Dr. Robert Peat and Andy Perkins, and for their regular updates on the review at meetings with myself and my colleague Shona Robison. Progress to implement the Commission's recommendations has not been good enough or fast enough. The Commission's review sets out very clearly the actions that need to be taken across the city by a range of partners. The recommendations must be accepted in full and implemented as quickly as possible. Presiding Officer, this is a relatively short debate, so I'm not going to cover the ground that Mr. Marra covered, but I would hope that my contribution is seen as complementary to his and not trying to set a different picture. But the Commission also recognised some of the progress that has been made since their original report. One significant development is the multi-agency rapid response to non-fatal overdoses, which Positive Steps are playing a significant role in with partners across our city. People are most at risk after they experience a non-fatal overdose, and evidence-based interventions like this are crucial for saving lives. Significant progress has also been made with the Dundee Take Home Naloxone project, the Hillcrest Futures also delivering a peer naloxone training and supply project, and I'll give way.
Michael Marra.
Member for giving way. Does he not share my frustration, though? I agree in terms of the non-fatal overdose pathway work, but that was initiated by Tayside Police, by Police Scotland and police officers. And actually, it's the central problem of the core facility in terms of the ISMs, DDARs, the substance misuse services, the lack of change there, that's actually the key issue that's arising from this report.
Joe Fitzpatrick, so, give us the time
as
back.
I said, those are areas which I think you covered pretty well. My view is that we will only really make progress on this area if we work in partnership across our city and elsewhere in Scotland as well. I think there is some huge work being done, but where we're going to make a real difference is where we work in partnership. So I'm going to be talking, I think, about some of those partnerships, which, particularly ones which have been highlighted by the Commission and others. So Dundee Hillcrest Futures peer naloxone training is one example of that, saving lives every day. Police Scotland officers now carry naloxone, and I want to thank our local officers for everything that they do to support people in distress and to disrupt the supply of drugs. I also welcome the investment being made by the Scottish Government through the National Mission. This funding for Dundee includes a number of significant projects, a community wellbeing centre for Hillcrest City Centre premises, which will deliver 24/7 crisis care and an integrated drug response to alcohol and mental health needs, one of the things that Mr. Marra talked about. The transformational primary care shared care programme, which will enable people to access the full range of services within their GP practice, something which is almost unheard of in our city. A new dedicated mother and child residential recovery house in the city to be run by Aberlour in partnership with Hillcrest. DVV A's five-tier recovery programme at the Lochie Hub, soon to be expanded to Whitfield, a women's hub by RASAC to support women with substance dependency and additional complex needs. Positive Steps work to engage and supply victims of cuckooing and to deliver whole family emotional and practical support for those affected by drug-related deaths. Transform delivery of direct support to aid access to treatment and recovery. Bethany Christian Trust's Bridge to Freedom Recovery Programme. Bernardo's providing whole family support for families affected by substance use. And The Corner delivering support to young people affected by their own or a family member's substance use and who find it difficult to manage their accommodation. That's a range of some of the projects which are being supported by Scottish Government funding. But I, as I said earlier, I think partnership and connections are key. So I want to use some of my time to pay tribute to some of the city's other essential third sector organisations who are supporting people across the city and often go unrecognised. They do amazing work and they are saving lives every day. So the parish nurses at the steeple, navigators at Ninewells, soon to be expanded into the community, DVAs, Lochie Hub and their five-tier recovery programme, Hillcrest Futures, We Are With You, Planet Youth being rolled out by the Winning Scotland at Baldragon Academy and St Paul's Academy in my constituency, street soccer and at the Lynch in Charleston, Andy's Man Club, Wellbeing Works and many, many others. But, Presiding Officer, I recognise we have to talk about what more we can do. And this week I had a really good constructive meeting with Peter Crichton and his colleagues from Cranston to discuss their calls for an overdose prevention centre in Dundee. And I was pleased to back Cranston's pledge with discussions to follow as to how we can bring such a service to Dundee. Having seen an OPC in operation in Paris during my time as Public Health Minister, I know that they can make an important difference, helping to engage people with support services, reducing harms and saving lives. I want to see local partners...
You do need to wind up now, Mr Fitzpatrick.
And I'm so sorry to particularly Cranston, because the work that they are doing I think will make a huge difference to our city. So I'm so sorry that I haven't managed to cover all of the points that make the case for why that service should come to Dundee. But I call on colleagues across the chamber to work with me and work with Peter and Cranston to bring that service to Dundee. Again, just to conclude, Presiding Officer, I want to thank the Dundee Drugs Commission for all of their work. Their recommendations set out a clear path ahead, and I'm confident that as a city we can make the progress necessary to improve services and save lives. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Fitzpatrick. I now call Claire Baker, who joins us remotely, to be followed by Miles Briggs. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to begin by thanking the Dundee Drugs Commission for the pile of work it has undertaken over the past 4 years. The Commission's reports are thoughtful, thorough and provide a real insight into the huge challenges and barriers faced by individuals suffering from addiction and accessing treatment services and other key forms of support in Dundee. The Commission has given a voice to a group whose cries for help have too often fallen on deaf ears. I wish to pay tribute to all those with lived experience who provided evidence to the Commission. I appreciate this will have been incredibly difficult to deliver, but sharing those experiences has given rise to a suite of strong recommendations that must be urgently implemented. As Chair of the Commission, Dr. Robert Peat, emphasised, while there may be challenging to deliver, all of them are achievable. There can't be any further delays. We need action now and that lives depend on it. This includes action on the medical assisted treatment standards, which the Commission have described as a game changer. It's deeply frustrating that nearly 3 years after the Commission highlighted the need for same-day prescribing and nearly 3 years after a public health emergency was declared, only one ADP is fully delivering on this recommendation on the MAT Standard 1. Only one. It is simply not good enough. The abject failure to fully implement the 9 other standards across the country by April 22, as was promised, is also deeply concerning. We must urgently make all 10 standards a reality for those on the ground. We need more than warm words. Those on the front line are key to ensuring the standards are fully implemented and sustained in future years. We must ensure that staff in the drugs and alcohol sector receive greater recognition for the vital role they play in society. This means better pay, secure employment, and more opportunities for professional development and career progression. This will be essential to achieving retention and recruitment. It's clear from recent reports that many staff in the drug and alcohol sector and health and social care services more generally have been under-resourced, undervalued and under pressure for far too long. I recognise the Scottish Government will publish a workforce plan after recess, but it shouldn't have taken 3 years after the drugs death crisis was declared for a public health emergency to do this. The development of medical assisted treatment in relation to benzodiazepine and cocaine use is another area requiring urgent action. This will be critical to help turn the tide on the rapid increase in overdose deaths, which these drugs have been implemented alongside opioids. We must also ensure that young people experiencing drug harms have access to specialised treatment services. A study published late last year by the Scottish Government highlighted concerns that there were no residential services tailored towards the specific needs of children and young people in Scotland. It says the lack of services tailored towards young people was concerning, given the markedly different profile of drug use among this population group. As my colleague Michael Marra emphasised, the lessons learned in Dundee are ones that can be applied at the national level. This includes the need for health needs assessments across all ADPs, the integration of drug and alcohol services with mental health provision. This is crucial, and I've been disappointed by the lack of progress in North Tayside on this issue. Services that fit the needs of the individual rather than individual having to fit the service, and giving the third sector a greater say in planning and delivering services. And independent external oversight will be essential going forward. All drugs deaths are preventable. We must act with urgency. We cannot keep talking about a public health emergency without taking emergency action. We cannot continue to delay implementation and miss deadlines. We cannot and must not find ourselves in the same situation 3 years from now. We owe it to all those who are crying out for help and to all those who have tragically lost their lives to get this right. Drive and determination from political leaders will be essential to delivering change. We cannot simply let this crisis continue. And kindness, compassion and hope for those suffering from addiction must be our guiding principle throughout. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Baker. I now call Miles Briggs to be followed by Mercedes de Alba for 4 minutes, please, Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start, like others, by thanking Michael Marra for bringing this debate to the Chamber today and for hosting the round table. I certainly found it very useful to meet with some of the members of the Commission and for his thoughtful speech as well. In March 2022, the report by the Dundee Drugs Commission was nothing short of damning. And following the publication of the initial report and recommendations of 2019, and it is clear, and I think this debate's demonstrated, that the pace of change has been too slow and progress limited. Now, the COVID-19 pandemic has not helped, but the vast majority of stakeholders believe that the pandemic has not been the sufficient reason for the glacial pace of change. Let's not forget that Scotland's drug deaths crisis is a public health emergency. It was before the pandemic. And as the Commission's report emphasises, it's not fair to expect, pandemic or no pandemic, that significant focus and efforts should not have been made in responding to that emergency. Now, last week, Angela Constance told the Scottish Parliament that alcohol and drug partnerships had fallen short of the target to embed MAT standards across all ADPs by April of 2022. The Commission's report says that they would be a game changer, and I think we all agree about that, but it's making sure that these are actually implemented, which I think this debate really has given an opportunity to think about. In 2020, people from the most deprived areas were 18 times more likely to have a drug-related death than those from the least deprived areas. Scotland's drug death rate is 3.5 times that of the UK. It's also higher than any other European country, and unfortunately, Dundee is at the very heart of this public health emergency. And the statistics are bleak. Between 2016 and 2020, Dundee City averaged the highest drug-related death rate per 1,000 people, with 39 per 100,000 of the population. Now, the Dundee Drugs Commission points to the fact that there is plenty of work which must be done to implement the recommendations, and I agree. And as outlined and revealed last week, despite setting that target last year to ensure that MAT standards were going to be fully embedded across the country, as Claire Baker's outlined, they have not been. And just 17% of standards have actually been implemented. That is shameful. We need to also see all these delivered across all alcohol and drug partnership areas. And I think Parliament really needs to know why this hasn't happened. What has happened to that public emergency promise and response from the government? New recommendations also looked towards that only half of the standards will be now implemented by next April, and these will only be partially implemented. So across Scotland there is also unwarranted variation. I think that's something the Minister needs to also be incredibly mindful of, and I think Parliament is concerned about. Now, in the time I have today, I also wanted to highlight two areas, the limited progress we've seen in terms of supporting families. Now, I welcome the work of organisations like Scottish Families Affected by Alcohol and Drugs. They are playing an incredibly positive role in supporting anyone concerned about someone else's alcohol or drug use in Scotland. And I welcomed the monies made available within the National Development Fund to help support families. But we need to see more, and what I was really taken with during the round table was how families still want to play a major part in taking this forward, a public health solution, and also need to be part of what is often, they are often, the 24-hour support for people struggling with addictions, and often feel that their views and the support they're trying to give is not taken into account. So I think that's something I hope the Minister will revisit. But finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, I also wanted to put on record my concern with regards to where we are now with alcohol deaths. In 2020, the number of people who tragically died directly because of alcohol death increased by 17% to 1,190 of our fellow Scots. Now, I welcome the fact the government have called this a twin public health emergency of both drug and alcohol harms, but we are not seeing the focus on alcohol that we should. I raised this with the Public Health Minister and was incredibly disappointed with the response I received, that not these MAT standards will not actually be in place around alcohol treatments until 2024. I don't think that's acceptable. And I hope in responding, the Minister will look towards the Scottish Government taking forward a rethink on that issue. I think it's incredibly important that they do. Finally, this may be the last debate before our summer recess, but the issues which we know so many people are facing will be there when we return. And I hope Parliament must and will continue to press the Government to act and deliver on these promises. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. And I call Mercedes Villalba to be followed by Paul Sweeney for around 4 minutes. Ms Villalba.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank my North East colleague, Michael Marra, for bringing forward this important motion for debate today. Just 2 years ago, Scotland recorded its largest ever number of drugs-related deaths at 1,339. This rate of drugs deaths was 3.5 times greater than that of the UK as a whole, and it was also higher than the rate observed in any other European country. So as MSPs, I'm sure that we've all observed the impact of Scotland's drugs deaths crisis on the communities that we represent. In my home city of Dundee, we lost 57 of our neighbours to drugs-related deaths in 2020. And throughout much of the last decade, Dundee regularly had the highest recorded proportion of drugs deaths in Scotland. On my own street, I see the daily impact that drug misuse is having on the community, and in many ways, it's a microcosm of the city's wider drugs use issues. So that's why I welcome the work of the Dundee Drugs Commission, which has sought to reduce both drugs deaths and to improve access to treatment in the city. But 2 years on from its initial report on the issue, the Commission's findings in its recent review make for stark reading. Many individuals still find themselves facing few treatment options and a lack of joint working among the services encompassing the Dundee Partnership. So I welcome the Commission's recommendations, including the need for independent scrutiny of progress being made by the Dundee Partnership, better allocation of the substance use budget, and the design of a recovery-oriented system of care. And I would urge Dundee City Council and the wider Dundee Partnership to seriously reflect on these recommendations as part of the recently revised 5-year drug and alcohol recovery plan. I believe that Scotland's drugs death crisis has been exacerbated by the failed criminalisation model, but it hasn't been helped by Scottish Government inaction either. Last week, the Minister admitted that progress is neither good enough nor quick enough, with most council areas in Scotland failing to fully implement the medication-assisted treatment standards. And while the Scottish Government now recognises the need for increased investment in drug and alcohol services, we cannot ignore the fact that they imposed cumulative cuts of over £40 million in recent years. So we need to see urgent action from the Scottish Government and a commitment to pursue alternative approaches to criminalisation. So that's why I support my colleague Paul Sweeney's calls for the introduction of safe consumption rooms, and it's also why I believe we need to have a serious debate about decriminalisation and what a modern drugs policy for Scotland should look like. Presiding Officer, I'd like to conclude by emphasising that the only way we will ever truly tackle drug use is not by criminalisation. We need to address the societal issues which often drive individuals to drugs use in the first place. For too long, communities like my own in Dundee have suffered the effects from poverty, homelessness and other inequalities. Change will require this Parliament to think and act bolder in terms of how we tackle these issues, including looking at the provision of universal public services. Because if we're serious about tackling Scotland's drugs deaths crisis, then we must also tackle its long-standing poverty crisis too.
Thank you, Mr. Alba. Now I call the final speaker in the open debate, Paul Sweeney, for around 4 minutes. Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I also want to thank my friend Michael Marra for bringing forward this critical and important, urgent motion to the attention of members of this Parliament today. And I also want to commend the work of the Dundee Drugs Commission and those with lived experience for feeding their expertise, insights and views into the Commission's comprehensive initial 2019 report, as well as their 2022 review on responding to the drug death crisis in Dundee. Of course, the report makes reference to the staggering 1,339 drug deaths in Scotland in 2020. And whilst we know that the most recent figures show that the number of drug deaths for the year leading up to March 2022 was 1,187, this is still an alarming, preventable rate of deaths in Scotland, well above the UK and European averages. And we know, as referred to by my friend Mercedes Villalba, that there is a link between deprivation, drug dependency, and Dundee particularly, like my constituency in Glasgow, has its own unique challenges when it comes to poverty. Both female and male life expectancy in Glasgow was the lowest in Scotland at 78 and 73 years respectively, with Dundee's male life expectancy also sitting at around 73 years. And when we take cognizance of the huge trauma that has on communities in our cities respectively, that lies at the heart of a lot of the difficulties we have in dealing with this crisis in our midst. And what really frustrates me in reading the report and is the fact that there simply isn't enough people with lived experience driving the change, driving the reform, and that is critical to what the Commission is trying to say to the Government. The primary recommendation, indeed, is to carry out a major health needs assessment for drug users, indeed to inform public and third sector agencies about what needs to happen, yet the response has not yet been implemented. And without the undertaking of a major health needs assessment, it's been difficult for the Commission to be able to be prescriptive about what Dundee needs with regards to new service creation. So I would like to advocate, of course, for a practical and specific tool that will be at the core of what we can do to fight against the drug death crisis in Dundee and across Scotland more broadly. Colleagues will be aware that I am currently consulting on my proposed bill to establish overdose prevention centres in Scotland. The facilities serve the purpose that the name suggests in preventing overdoses and saving lives, and I strongly believe they are a critical part of Scotland's response to the drug death crisis. These facilities across the world have proven to be an effective way to reverse overdoses, prevent overdoses, engage with people who are currently at the margins of society, and provide people with the resources and support in relation to the issues stemming from their addiction. I've seen the benefits firsthand, and I pay tribute to Peter Crichton and Cranston in the gallery today for the work they have done to drive the pace in Scotland, far more than any government agency. They, having volunteered with my friend Peter, we saw firsthand the impact the unofficial pilot had in Glasgow. 9 overdoses reversed, 8 lives saved, because 2 overdoses were in relation to one individual, 900 injections supervised. But actually what we found was the interaction and the building up of self-esteem and a sense of validation amongst people was one of the most important parts, just providing that interface for people to start to engage, to get support, to get even something simple as a protein shake and a Mars bar was actually something that they really needed and found a way to validate themselves. And the recent example of the New York pilot is another perfect example of the efficacy of OPCs, with 110 overdoses being reversed there between November last year and February this year, striking in its impact. And I, Deputy Presiding Officer, to come back to the Dundee Drugs Commission's recommendations, it is a source of extreme frustration that they have not yet been fully implemented some 2 years on from the initial report. And I fear this lagging response in Dundee is also indicative of the national picture, where things are moving too slowly as the deaths mount up and up. I will mention once more that the most recent annual drug death figure, 1,187 people dying of a drug-related death between March last year and March this year. There is an urgent need for quick and cohesive action. In Dundee, that means the comprehensive implementation of all aspects of the Commissioner's recommendations urgently. And in Scotland more broadly, that means establishing a framework and a licensing scheme for overdose prevention centres as soon as possible. And I hope my bill out for consultation will drive the pace of that change. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Sweeney. I now call on the Minister to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to commend Michael Marra for securing this debate, providing the opportunity to focus on one of our cities most affected by drug deaths and harms. And I want to start my contribution, like others, by thanking and paying tribute to the Dundee Drug Commission for its work, for both reports on reducing drug deaths in the city and on their clarion call for kindness, compassion and hope to be at the absolute core of everything we all do to turn the tide on this drug deaths emergency. It is my view that this latest report provides a comprehensive and fair assessment of the progress that the city has made, and it clearly sets out the work that Dundee needs to do now. This includes improving services for people who are at risk and for their families, as well as leadership and oversight from those in positions of authority in Dundee to make this happen. The report also highlights areas of good practice, which of course is heartening. However, there is no hiding that there is much still to be done in Dundee, and when I met the Commission on the very day that they published their latest report, their sense of frustration was not lost on me. And I have met with leaders from the Dundee Partnership on a number of occasions, and most recently this week. And I have stressed the need for Dundee to act with urgency to address the report recommendations. And I continue to offer my support to help deliver the change that is needed. Because the report is clear in its recommendations that any plan produced by Dundee should be subject to external scrutiny. And I am supportive of this. As I said in my statements on accountability of drug services last month, transparency and openness to challenge, particularly by people with lived experience and their families, is key to the delivery of effective change, both at a local and national level.
Michael Marra.
I thank the Minister for giving way. Would she think that the model that's been pursued in terms of the oversight group that's put in place for the delivery of the Strang Review, which the Minister knows has been years in preparation and no delivery against those recommendations, the oversight group appointed by ministers and reporting to ministers on that basis is a model of external expert validation that could also include lived experience, that would actually give some of these recommendations the chance for the kind of oversight that the Commission is clearly calling for, and that would address the issue of despair that they feel at the lack of progress?
Minister, I'll give
you the feedback. So, the point about oversight is important. We, of course, have a national oversight group for the national mission. What I'll do is I will go through the actions that we are taking right now to assist Dundee. I'll try and do that in a bit of detail. But I've also been clear with the partnership that in terms of the work that we are doing, in terms of ministerial direction, that if there is no quick improvements, we will of course have to look at all other options. Presiding Officer, I'm going to make some progress on that. We can certainly, you're always welcome to pick this up offline as well. Presiding Officer, we are taking a number of actions and a number of areas to support Dundee to respond to the Commission's report. Quite rightly, people have highlighted the importance that MAT standards set out that rights-based approach and will ensure people are able to make informed choices about the type of treatment and help available to them, and in turn ensure consistency of services across the country. And the MAT implementation and support team are continuing to work very closely with NHS and third sector services in Dundee to implement these standards, and that also includes additional support in terms of that progress and programme of change that is necessary. However, Dundee still has work to do, in particular around MAT Standard 1, which ensures people receive same-day treatment. So, as with other parts of Scotland, I am using the powers of direction available to Scottish ministers under the Public Bodies Joint Working Act 2014 to compel chief executives and chief officers across the NHS, integrated joint boards and local authorities to implement these standards, and for those same leaders to personally sign off on improvement plans, and in the case of Dundee and Tayside, to be subject to an enhanced level of monthly reporting. And if you want to make another point now, I'll take it.
Michael Marra.
I thank the Minister for that, because my concern is this timetable. As I mentioned in my speech, MAT Standard 1 was recommended in the first report of the Dundee Drugs Commission years ago, and we're no further forward, it would seem, in the actual delivery of that recommendation. So the Minister is essentially saying not yet, in terms of actually some form of oversight. When, Minister? When will you take that action to say that it's not good enough and that a different regime will be put in place?
Minister.
I absolutely am taking action, and I appreciate that it's perhaps difficult for members who have not served in government to understand the nature of ministerial direction, but the nature of this ministerial direction is unprecedented, because the challenge we face is unprecedented. There has never been before ministerial direction on integrated joint boards, for example. This is ministerial direction on the National Health Service, IJBs and local authorities to implement at pace the whole system of change that is required. There are other public and practical and financial support that we are working very closely with Dundee to deliver. But I will say to Mr. Marra, if I don't see quick changes, so the first improvement plans will be available at the end of recess, and as I've said, that Dundee and Tayside have monthly reporting. So I am looking for change within months, and most certainly not years, because I agree this has went on far too long, and I'm not prepared to put up with it. And I know this Parliament is not prepared to put up with it. And most importantly, I know the communities that I serve and that you serve are not prepared to put up with it. So nothing is off the table. But make no mistake about it, the ministerial direction is unprecedented, because I am absolutely serious about this. Presiding Officer, Mr. Marra, I'm really conscious of time, it mentioned the importance of primary care. And this is one area where we are financially and practically supporting Dundee in their endeavours to establish multidisciplinary community-based teams and to move away from that single city delivery site at Constitution House. And we are investing £1.8 million over 4 years to support the delivery of drug treatment within primary care. And this will significantly increase the capacity of the system to provide up to 800 people with the protective treatment in community-based, non-stigmatised settings. And this will also ensure that treatment is delivered alongside general health care, meaning that people with underlying conditions are able to access the other services that they need within one setting. And I also, as a former mental health officer, recognise that testimony from people with lived experiences on the challenges when trying to access mental health support along with support for addictions. And that's why there is the Healthcare Improvement Scotland work, which started in Dundee, and I know the Commission paid tribute to this work with that aim of fully integrating substance use and mental health services in the city. And this is not only vital learning for Dundee, but will be vital learning across Scotland. And Mr Marra, I think, rightly asked questions about, you know, why are we not seeing progress? What are the blockages? I've touched on some of them, you know, in and around leadership. There's also the importance of ensuring that investment reaches where it is intended to reach. But a major asset for Dundee is their fabulous third sector. And I have seen that from the many visits I've made to Dundee over the years in different portfolios. There is a vital role in delivering person-centred services that is provided by the third sector. They are on the front line and they are well positioned to establish trust and relationships with people and to take that holistic approach. And the third sector in Dundee, as elsewhere in Scotland, are absolutely key to transformational service redesign and that move away from centralised, over-medicalised models of care. And there is a number of voluntary sector organisations that we are investing. Joe Fitzpatrick mentioned the Aberlour Child and Mother House. I too had the pleasure of meeting Cranston today to hear about their work elsewhere in the UK in and around different models of care also. Presiding Officer, the Dundee's Drugs Desk Commission report is challenging, and so it should be, but it also clearly speaks to the many assets in Dundee, assets that will assist those who are responsible locally and nationally to deliver the transformational change that is needed. And this includes the expertise of people with lived and living experience, the insight of frontline staff and the innovation of the third sector. And while this has been a difficult experience for the Commission, I have no doubt that their work will indeed have a lasting legacy, and I intend to play my part in that.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate. I congratulate all of you on sticking with it through to the last debate before recess. Can I wish you a good recess? I hope you manage to get something of a rest over the period. And with that, I close this meeting of Parliament.